Chad Schmidt. Mary Lou Sondag. Jennifer Stevens. And Leah Whitaker, who is also a new member of the board. Everybody should have a brochure on your chair, and I know many of you are involved with friends' activities throughout the year. If you're not, I would encourage you to become a member. Every May, we have a garden party, a June book sale, and again, in September, we have a better book sale. Every year, the Friends Board presents a gift to the library and a gift to the foundation. We get 100% of the net revenue from the book sales to the library and 50% of the membership dues to the foundation. Ward is the president of the Board of Trustees.
I would
like to give you a check.
With pleasure.
Ward, I check the amount of $3,120. Thank you.
Success. successful annual book sale as we do. Jane has been coming here on a weekly basis, along with Mary Lou Sontag, and they go through and sort all of the books for the book sale. They put them in different categories, they know what to keep and what not to keep, and they're great. And Jane has just been learning the work and the ropes with Mary Lou Sontag, who's done that for years, and they are the reason the book sale is such a success. Mary Lou, would you be willing to accept this work today?
Yes.
Historic preservation. Look at that view. Isn't that wonderful?
I mean, it looks now like it did back then. This is a recent photograph. And that's because the people who were involved with the Calais preservation either own the land or have restrictive covenants on all the land visible from that building. So you'll never look out from Calais and see golden arches. that preserve. Very, very foresight. Now, at the time when he went to the University of Wisconsin for 1 year and then went to Chicago to start his career. Chicago at that time, the late 80s, was a hotbed of architecture because of the 1871 Chicago fire. They had to rebuild the whole city. So it was a great place for a young guy to start out in architecture. And this is the kind of building that would be common, the Victorian style, highly decorated, highly stylized. Here is a picture of a modern home number 64 from the Sears catalog in 1909, thanks to the collection at the Willard Library, by the way. Now, this is what would be common. This is what Wright was designing. This is 1902. Now, can you imagine a Civil War veteran, there were a lot of them around at that time, walking down the street and coming upon something like this? Just genius. His career was marked by 70 years of unbelievable productivity and creativity. Quallen Water, which is a World Heritage Site, the Johnson Wax headquarters in Racine, Wisconsin. This is near my house. You could film a Star Wars movie there. This is from 1936. Now, he not only had the aesthetic creativity, but he also had engineering creativity. Look at that research tower. You see a row of glass, a row of bricks, a row of glass, a row of bricks. How can you put bricks on top of glass? Well, he figured out a way. That tower is built like a tree. And there's a central core, like a tree trunk. And the floors are built off of the central trunk. One of the first times that was used. Now, this is the interior of the Johnson Glass building. It looks kind of like a forest with a dab of light coming in from the ceiling. Code of the kind of building codes at the time in Wisconsin stated that a 21-foot column, which this is, which supports 6 tons, which that does, has to be 30 inches wide to meet code. Those bases are 9 inches wide. So we got a problem here. And so the commissioner said, right, you've got to build one of these things. We need to test it to make sure that this is going to hold up. So they did. They built one of those. And spoiler alert, there's a guy who was very involved in the engineering of how to make these columns, which we'll learn about later. So they built a column, and they started stacking sandbags on top of it. And they got up to, if it had to support six tons, it supported 12 tons. So the commissioner said, good job. Thanks a lot. Wright says, keep piling it up. So they keep piling and piling. They fill the whole top of that pedal with sand. They start putting pig iron on it because the weight wasn't so big. They finally got up to 60 tons. Short of that, Wright went up to it, kicked it, hit it with his cane and all that kind of stuff. It was kind of dangerous to do. And finally, it finally gave that 60 tons, which was 10 times what it was supposed to do. By the way, when 60 tons fell 21 feet, it damaged a water main that was 30 feet below ground. Now, you'll also notice that Wright designed the furniture. These desk chairs and desks that are typical for Wright. Just one more story. The original chairs were three-legged chairs, and people fell out of the chairs. And so Mr. Johnson called Wright into his office one time to start a new beginning. Johnson had positioned one of the three-legged chairs by his desk. And Wright comes in, sits in one of the three-legged chairs, and Mr. Johnson behind his desk says, Mr. Wright, we're having a problem with your chairs. People are falling out of them. And Wright said, well, how many legs are there on one of these chairs? And Johnson says, well, three. Wright says, and how many legs are there on the people that you employ to sit in these chairs? And And Jonathan says, well, two. Wright says, well, that makes five legs, which ought to be sufficient. Well, just then, Johnson flips a pencil off his desk and it falls to the side of Wright, who leans over to pick it up and falls on her. You'll notice there are four legs. And this, you know, the mothership has landed. Wonderful, it's a wonderful church. And of course, it's a good time. Now, somebody had to figure out how to build a spiral museum. Right? You can see that, but somebody's got to figure out how to build it. And we'll get to that person, perhaps. Now, all of America was drastically affected by the stock market crash in 1929. The Great Depression hit in the 30s. That drives up commissions for architecture. And so Wright started a school to maybe have some cash flow from students, but he also dedicated effort toward creating well-designed homes for the common man that would be affordable. We call it Usonian Home. That's Usonian U of the United States of North America. In order to make these homes affordable, he came up with the concepts of eliminating the unnecessary. There's no attics, no basements, no dining rooms, no applied decoration. We pick unique sites to build these houses on, whatever architects were to touch. There's use of local materials. They often had horizontal lines, what's called board batten siding. This is the street side of the house where you don't see any windows, you don't see a front door. It's very private on the street side. Flat roofs with large overhangs. There are windows just beneath the roof, that's called a clear story window, that lets light in, but people can't see in, so you don't need curtains or blinds. Wright claims that he invented the carport, which would be less expensive than a garage. And yet the backs of these houses were open, wide open, floor to ceiling windows that would let the outside in, as this concept is. And so even though the houses were small, you would have a wonderful vista out the back into your courtyard or garden. He called these polywog houses sometimes because the polywog's head would be the left side of the screen, or the left side of the house where the public's first spaces were, and then the tail of the polywog would be where the private apartments, where the bedrooms would be. This is an interior of the Usonian house. They're generally centered around a hearth, the hearth of the home. The same materials were used inside and out. There's often built-in storage and furniture. The decoration comes from the structure. Who would put wallpaper anywhere and the windows that bring the outside in. There's also this long corridor here, that a gallery that's very common for bedrooms when we often have. And they were often designed on a geometric grid. This is a house that was designed on a diamond-shaped grid. This actually is the Krauss house, which is in St. Louis. It's a wonderful gem. They were often built on concrete slabs with a pipe tubing going through the slabs that allow circulation of hot water for the heating. The walls were made of what's called sandwich walls, where there'd be a plywood and then exterior and interior boards on either side to be self-supporting. So that's the concept of the Usonian houses that Franklin Wright developed in the early 30s. And so for the next portion, we'll turn things over to Professor Strobel. And also we need to give a credit to Willard Library for the first slide she's going to show.
Where they didn't want them to be in order to solve these problems. So here we have William Wesley Peters, went by a couple of different nicknames, Bill, Wes. He graduated from Fosse High School in 1929. You might take a look at the things that he expressed interest in. Jim and I have talked about this a fair amount, but the attention to detail and organization that you see in something like chess, I think, translates really well to somebody who's such a gifted architectural engineer. And also puppetry as well, the idea of crafting something, particularly out of natural materials. So after he graduated from Bossy, and Wes Peters, we had a couple of Facebook questions about who Wes Peters was descended from. He was the son of Frederick Peters, one of the early editors of the Evansville Courier. So Wes grew up, he was born in Terre Haute, but he grew up in Evansville. And after graduating from Bossy, he attended what was then Evansville College from 1929 to 1930. Here's a picture of him while he was at what we now refer to as UB. But he decided after a year of being at UB that he wanted to go on to MIT. I'll go back here for a moment. So he went to Massachusetts for a year. And while he was at MIT, he saw a notice on the bulletin board there that said that Frank Lloyd Wright was opening a fellowship program, an internship program, basically, at Spring Green, Wisconsin, and interested people could apply. And he was interested, in fact. And so he traveled up to Wisconsin and met Frank Lloyd Wright and was able to, Wes Peters was able to write a check for $675 for this fellowship. And so if you think about that, in 1930s dollars, that was quite a lot of money. And so he joined the fellowship at Taliesin. Here's where the story gets really interesting. And I have to thank Jim for the decoration of the slide. So there are a couple of different stories about the relationship between Svetlana Wright and Wes Peters. One is that, well, first of all, back up here, Svetlana was the daughter of Frank Lloyd Wright's third wife. I have not nearly enough time to go into Frank Lloyd Wright's romantic affairs during this talk tonight. But they were married, okay? So this is the daughter of wife number three, but not the biological daughter of Frank Lloyd Wright, but she's very, very dear to Frank Lloyd Wright. One story is that Mrs. Wright encouraged Wes Peters and Svetlana to spend time together. They called her Svet, encouraged Wes and Svet to spend time together. One of the biographies of Frank Lloyd Wright talks about how Mrs. Wright would always suggest that Svet ride along with Wes Peters when they went on firewood runs. They fell in love, and Frank Lloyd Wright was not happy when he discovered that they had fallen in love. Wes Peters was very upright. He went to Wright and said, "I've fallen in love. I would like to marry her." And Wright was displeased. Wes Peters decided it was a good idea to go ahead and kind of leave for a little bit. And Svetlana thought it was a good idea as well. And so Svetlana went to Chicago, where she studied music from a woman who was in the Chicago Symphony Orchestra. And she lived with that woman as well. And Wes came back home to Evansville. Wes traveled up to Chicago once a month, and they eventually got married on April 1st, 1935, here in Evansville. Another thing that Svetlana was working on during this period was designing dollhouse furniture, and we'll return to that topic a little bit later. So, after the marriage happened, they returned to Spring Green, things were good, and they had a couple of children shortly thereafter. What we're looking at is, of course, Frank Lloyd Wright in the center here, Wes Peters over on the left-hand side, and Eugene Masalinka, graphic artist, over on the right-hand side. And one thing to think about with Wes Peters is how big he was as a man. And if you haven't had the chance to visit the Peters Marginot House, I strongly encourage you to do so, because it's a wonderful architectural gem. And you can also notice how relatively low the ceilings are. Wes Peters was 6'4" tall. So I always think of him as kind of not quite crouching in this house, but his head being really close to the top of the ceiling. There's a story that one of the first times that Wright was like 6 or 7 inches shorter than Peters, met here, who said, "Sit down, Wes, you're ruining the scale of the house." So anyhow, during the time, I'm going to call it the cooling off period, when Wes was in Evansville and Svet was in Chicago, Wes designed three houses. Two of them were built. One of them is the Peters Margadon House, and we're looking at a 1934 picture of the Peters Margadon House. It's called the Peters Margadon House because it was designed for Wes Peters' cousin's family, the Margadons. Okay? And James Margadon worked for Wes Peters' father at the newspaper. While Wes was in Evansville, he also worked on some architectural renovations to his father's office, to the newspaper office as well. One of the houses that was built, that Wes designed, besides the Peters Margadon House, is called the Price House. This was built, it's larger than the Peters Margadon House, and it was destroyed by arson in 1969. Yeah, unfortunately. The third house was designed but never built for Jerome Salm. Some of you may remember Salm's department store. So I like to joke that he took a look at, you know, Wes Peters' design, and I think he was almost too modern for him because he chose a different type of style. So the Salm house was never built. It was designed by Wes, but it was never built according to Wes Peters' plan. Okay, so let's go back to the Peters Margadon house. I'm going to explain some of the key features of this house. I hope to dovetail with what Jim has told you are the characteristics of a Usonian house. So we're looking at a kind of an aerial view of the original location of the Peters Margadon house. This is the Peters Margadon house here. It was originally built at 1506 East Indiana Avenue. So if any of you are aficionados of the pub, you know where Indiana is. It's also by X-Men's Beauty Salon, I always remember that. And the Garwood Baptist Church is another kind of key marker in that neighborhood. So, Wes Peters, one of the dictates that I believe that he absorbed from Frank Lloyd Wright was to pay attention to the site and to let the site influence, you know, dictate, is a little stronger word, how you situate the house. And so Wes Peters knew how most of the other houses on this street were built. And if you notice, and this is, you know, you drive through the neighborhood today, almost all of the houses are so close to the sidewalk. So we're looking at the sidewalk there, we're looking at the street here. And Wes Peters thought, okay, I'm building a relatively small house for my cousin's family. How am I going to make this seem larger? Well, I'm going to give them a really large front lawn, which is what he did. So notice that on a narrow lot, on a 40-foot urban lot, he sites the building far back, really closer to what became an alleyway here than the sidewalk. And so again, this gave a very large front yard, which was helpful for a family of four children. But think about privacy too. Think about what, you know, would happen if these neighbors looked into these windows. You're looking into your neighbor's kitchen window, into the bedroom window. Not really a sight you always want to see, right? So what happened with this house, this is the living room, these are the bedrooms. And so the view that the Margadons got was a green out their windows and their doors instead of their neighbor's windows. Again, giving a sense that this is like less claustrophobic sighting than perhaps these two houses together. Also, of course, allows for greater circulation of air. So I would just first draw your attention to the unique sighting of this house. And we have tried to replicate that sighting at the university. We haven't been able to completely copy it, but I'll explain that when we get to that part of the presentation. So again, this is what the house looked like in 1934. We think that James's wife was responsible for the landscaping that you see here. Again, we tried to recreate that as much as possible at UNE's campus. I would draw your attention to the light box here. The one that we have at Reed is a reconstruction, but I would emphasize, I would kind of point your attention to the fact that it matches the architectural style of the house itself. Going into the Peters Margaion house, so Jim mentioned the hearth being the central kind of part of the house. That's key for most of Frank Lloyd Wright's architecture and certainly his Usonian architecture. So we're looking at the hearth here in the center of the house. Jim also mentioned the fact that there's very little decoration. Wes Peters and his teacher, Frank Lloyd Wright, believed that the building material should be the decoration of the house, that the natural should be revealed in the house, and that's what you have here. Please notice that you have the kind of connection between the outside and the inside. So on the outside of the house, and I'll go back here for just a second, you'll see a better image in a moment. You have that board and batten decoration that Jim pointed out to you in the Jacob's house. You have that here, you have that here, and you also have a variation of it here on the inside of the house. Lots of natural light coming in as well to kind of give this sensation of spaciousness. We have transom windows in here that again allow for the circulation of air and light. Here's a nice detail of the great room of the Peters Margaion house. Notice again how that board and batten is brought inside, and the building materials, another thing that's characteristic of the Usonian house, is that the same type of building materials on the outside are often used on the inside. So we're dealing with oak on the outside and oak on the inside here as well. This is one of my favorite details of the house because you can definitely see this play between the horizontal and the vertical that really dominate the house. And so this is, and I'll talk about this in a moment, but this is where the parents slept for about a decade. There were four kids in this family, two parents and a big dog. And they slept in the bedrooms and the parents slept out in the great room. Here's one of Wes Peters' drawings for that particular interior wall that we were just looking at. You can see that here too. And please notice that the windows are often high at this house, again, to ensure privacy, similar to the clerestory windows that we saw in Jacob's house. So here's a plan of the house itself. Like I mentioned, we were just looking at the living room, and there's the fireplace. That's the footprint of the fireplace. And that's what I was just admiring right there, that wall right there. The bedrooms were here in the back, here and here. So the shape of the house is also pretty unique. We have a square and an envelope that intersect with each other, but intersect in kind of a unique way. You might notice that the footprint of the house looks like a kind of series of diamonds. You've got the diamonds formed here along with this arrow right here. And I'm going to show you this in these two slides as well. So there's the kind of key part of the house, but turned on its angle here, or turned on an angle like this. And then this part right here, this triangle is cut out. This part of the square is joined here. And then that becomes the kitchen right there. So it's a really unique footprint. I mean, think about your houses. Very few of your houses probably have this diamond that's connected to an arrow. It's very unusual. And there you can see that diagram again kind of turned on its side, the kitchen in the front part of the plan. So the exciting thing about this is that we have a prototype of a Usonian house here in Evansville on UB's campus. Certainly, Wes Peters was very indebted to Frank Lloyd Wright when he was working on this idea. He was working on it, though, when he was taking a break from Wright's studio. So that's something to think about. So he was absorbing, while he was at Taliesin from 1931 to 1933, he was learning about Usonian architecture. And what we have here is we have an example of Usonian architecture that's been modified, that's a prototype. It's not the first Usonian house, but it has many of the features of Usonian house. And for a community like Evansville, who's so interested in architectural and historical preservation and architecture, I think this is really a lovely addition to the buildings that we worked so hard to restore. So if you just look at these two images here, we were talking about the Jacobs House. Jim walked us through the details of the Jacobs House. You can see the similarity between the outside of the Jacobs House and the outside of the Peters Marginot House over here. So, the move. The move really was encouraged by the placement of the Peters Marginot House on Indiana Landmarks list of 10 most endangered buildings in Indiana. So that was the impetus for the move. Lots of community members came together. I like to think we formed a nice relationship with the university and decided to save the house. So in preparation of the move, one of the things that we needed to do was to basically move the flagstone path that led up to the house on the Indiana Street side. So what we're looking at here is the Indiana Street side. It's April 2016, and we had a bunch of SIG Eps from our campus and archaeology and art history students helping to dislodge 275 flagstones, okay, and put them on 5 pallets. Now, this was quite a production, but it was a lot of fun. This was really, it was a lovely spring day. There were a bunch of young men out there who really wanted to kind of flex their muscles. And then we had the archaeology and art history students who were out there who just wanted to kind of geek out and measure things. And so it was really delightful. Combination of personalities, plus Jim was there and Adam Green, who is a local architect who's been very involved in this project, and me. And it was a really fun day. So the flagstone path here was originally quarried by Wes Peters from the family farm at Apata Rocks, which was about an hour away from Evansville. So one thing to think about is Wes Peters, unlike his great teacher, is not working with a bunch of apprentices. He's executing all aspects of this house by himself. And his father keeps on saying, Wes, we gotta make it cheaper. And so, I like to think of him like sweating during, summer, laying down the flagstone, which about 40 of us in 2 hours, picked up and put on 5 different pallets here. And then we put the pallets in storage, and when we move the house to UV, we place some of those stones leading up to the house. We can't put the house on a lot that it goes back 40 feet because we didn't have that much space, but we used some of those stones. And there we are at really kind of hour 3. And the students really neatly numbered and placed, and they had this kind of fire engine, I don't know what it's called, where we're passing the stones along. Yeah. And it was really fun. It was one of those times where I'm reminded that some of the best learning occurs outside of the classroom on a beautiful day. So this is closer to August of 2016. So the house moved on August 25th, 2016. In preparation for the move, support beams needed to be placed under the house, and so that's what you see here in this picture. And then, the day of the move was 100 degrees. You know what it feels like in August, right? So I always tell this story. The move is supposed to take place at like 8:30 or 9, so I'd gotten the kids to school, and my husband, I'm taking a shower, and my husband comes in, and he's like, the house is moving. One of our friends had gone over to Indiana Street and started taking a video. The house had started moving early because it was hotter than Hades that day, and the construction crew wanted to move the house, and so I'm trying to race through getting ready to go so I can go see the house move down the street. So we had police lined up to be our police escort, because what we did is we went down Division the wrong way. We closed down Division. So on August 24th, Stuart Seabury of Indiana Landmarks and one of my students and I were knocking on the doors of Indiana Street, and also, I just noticed that Judy was here, and we were knocking on the doors telling people that they needed to have their cars off the street so that they wouldn't be in the way of this beautiful house moving down the street. So we have the police escort. And here we are going down Division the wrong way. For those of you guys who like Taroni's, Taroni's is right here. One of the Taroni's is right here, okay? So we're about, I'm trying to name all the landmarks. we're about to go under the Loy. So here we are going under the Loy. Yeah. Which is a picture that I really love. And to that end, I love this picture so much that I've had postcards made out of it. So, the postcards are at the back of the room. Philip Cooper took this really lovely picture. And this makes my art historian heart sing because it's in perfect perspective. So, if you imagine all those orthogonals, they would all go to one vanishing point if the house wasn't there. So, it's a beautifully centered picture. So, there, please feel free to take a postcard with you when you go. And so it arrived on campus. Lots of people came out to watch the move. It was a really fun day. The move itself took 2 hours. It was supposed to take 4 hours. Yeah. Again, it's one of those shocking things, like you gotta hurry up and get ready or you're gonna see goodness. Yeah. And you know, I'm so glad it didn't take that long because it was such a hot day. I mean, everybody was misting that day, I'll say. So here we are right next to the place where the house was eventually placed. The foundation was still being prepared at this point. So this is where the house stopped on August 25th. Now this was also a great date for the house to move because school started at UV on August 24th. And so for a lot of people, the first day of classes was the 25th because it was a Thursday. And some classes were on Wednesdays and some were on Thursdays. And so what I was able to do on my first day of classes is take my students out and they could be on the news, basically. I'm like, here's the house, here's what you need to know about it, here's some television crews, who wants to be on the news? And so I had at least 3 of my students on the news that day, so it was a really cool opportunity for them. Here's the house, winching onto its foundation. So again, the preparation for its placement on UV's campus, and then the house, how it looks at night. And this is actually, I need to credit this photograph to Jordan Barkley because he did a really excellent job of taking this picture. Now, we'll notice that this is kind of a nice image because we can see the board and batten exteriors here. These aren't clerestory windows, but they are really higher than your typical windows. So, and the house has been restored. We have been really lucky to have a good group of community members, many of whom are not affiliated with the UE, some who are affiliated with the UE. But this has really been a lovely marriage of people who are in the community who are interested in historical preservation and people who are on campus who really are excited to have this gem on our campus because it's a really fantastic teaching tool for students, of course, whom I teach our history to, but also for students who come from off campus. You know, students from age 6 to age 96 who want to know more about Frank Lloyd Wright, who know more about Smithsonian architecture and Wes Peters' interpretation of that. So the dedication, the house was dedicated on April 20th, 2017, and this picture is taken from the rooftop of Cook. So if you know UV's campus, the native grass garden is over here. Cook kind of sprawls out behind the native grass garden and comes around this way. This is Powell Hall over here. This is the dormitory. And you'll see that we have, again, a shorter pathway up to the house. So we had several different guests on the dedication day, but one of the most special guests in my mind was Brandon Peters. So Svetlana married Wes Peters. They had 2 boys, and tragically, Svet was killed in a car crash along with one of their sons. Their son, Brandon, who was the grandson of Frank Lloyd Wright and the son of Wes Peters and Svetlana, survived that crash. And he was able to travel down from Wisconsin for the dedication. So that was one of the really kind of special people who was at the dedication. So I'm going to pass the baton back to Jim, who's going to talk about the dollhouse project that I was talking about a few minutes ago.
Where was the Price House that had bars in them?
It was on Newburgh Road.
Yes.
Newburgh Road.
When Svetlana her father's reaction to the relationship she had with Wes Peters. She assumed the name of Sargon Wad. Sargon being Sargon of Akkad, who lived 4,300 years ago. What 16-year-old girl wouldn't want to be named Sargon if you had the chance? And Wild was from Austin Wild. And Heidi kind of went over the sad end to her life, although there was the reconciliation, that was wonderful. But when she was in Chicago, she and another one-year Taliesin fellow, a lady named Elizabeth Weber, or Betty, they started making townhouses. And Betty Weber wasn't a registered architect, but she could make townhouses. And so here's a relatively simple one that she made, and they made them and sold them. As time went by, she got a little fancier with it. This is Weber and Wild from the company that they made. The townhouse would cost $15. $5 to wire it, furniture was $5, and drapes were $3.50. The townhouses came with the furniture designed for them. This one, boy, that's another one by Betty Weber. That's a major townhouse. I think that's about $30. No, $60. $50, something like that. It's out there. Well, Wes Peters, I think, was kind of impressed with what these girls were doing. And so he got in on the act, and he designed a house for Mrs. Foltz in Evansville. The beauty of this is that this is Wes Peters in a blank piece of paper designing a house that he thinks would be cool. He doesn't have to worry about building codes or material costs or anything. He just designed. So this is pure Wes Peters imagination. This here is his chop, or I guess we call it an icon. We call it a chop. So I obtained this when I went to visit Brenda up at Spring Green. He kind of let me take a picture of it. This is kept in a box at the foot of his bed because it's one of the few things he has from his mom, because he was only 5 when she died. And I thought, wouldn't it be fun to build one of these? First of all, wouldn't it be fun to find one of these? And Foltz is here. They haven't been in their attic for a while. Let us know. So I brought these plans out to New Tech High School. Are y'all familiar with New Tech? Where their teaching protocol is project-based teaching. The teacher doesn't say, read chapter 3. The teacher says, you got to build something. And chapter 3's got some stuff on it. I build things, but you just get it done. So I thought, wouldn't this be a neat project? These kids could do little rulers and pencils and draw all stuff, do little spots, kind of like Santa's elves, like that kind of picture, fabricating this house. And they said, yeah, that's a great idea, but they envision it on a computer, the computer aided design. They tell the computer to tell the laser cutter to cut pieces of wood, I'm not sure what material they're using, fiber board. And for the furniture, let's just print it. So we're getting it done, not by the means that I had initially envisioned, but this has been a great project. And this is one of those unintended consequences of a preservation project. You know, now we've got high school kids that are learning about the Depression and learning about Wes Peters and Frank Lloyd Wright. It's kind of a long icing. And when it's done, it's going to be in the display in the house. So I think Heidi will then finish up.
I think one other thing that is very interesting about the golf box project is, like Jim said, it involves high school students, so it's bringing this full circle to incorporate another group of students, but also that it's very modernist, right? I didn't have a dollhouse that I lived like like this when I was growing up. You know, thinking of the ones with the columns and things like that, the more kind of traditional ones. So I think that you see, even in this, an idea of how Wes Peters was designing. The lines are really different than what we see in the traditional dollhouse. And I think in some ways are really similar to what we see Wes Peters doing in his designs here in Evansville for the Psalm House that was never built in particular.
One other thing before I forget, I would like to introduce somebody who was in our midst. And this is Judy Margaret Stewart.
Yes, which is why I said hello to her.
Judy grew up in the house. She was sleeping in one of the bunk beds, looking out through one of the upper windows, and enjoyed the big front yard. So afterwards, if you have any specific questions, Judy is the expert.
Well, she's also a great source for unanswered tour questions that I get, because I get questions I do not know the answer to. And so there was a place that was next to the fireplace. I should have realized it was for fireplace tools, but I didn't. And so somebody asked me what it was for, and I said, I don't know. I will look back to you on that. And so the next time I saw Judy, I said, Judy, what was that used for? And she said, well, that's where we put the fireplace tools. And that, to me, is like a part of the genius of the house, because there's so many built-ins. And I should have emphasized that more, but both Frank Lloyd Wright and Wes Peters used a lot of built-ins to minimize the kind of occupied space in their houses. So when you come and see the Peters Margonaut house, you'll see built-ins like bookshelves and things like that, and the fireplace slab, like I told you, again, as a means of kind of maximizing the house, because the footprint of the house is 552 square feet. Right? Yeah. So it is truly a tiny, tiny house. Okay, so I'd like to thank several people. I'd like to thank Greg, first of all, for having us here. Thank you, Greg. And Andrew for the great introduction. I'd like to thank Joe Atkinson, who's not here, but also, oh, are you up there, Joe?
I'm right here.
Okay.
I'm right here.
Hi, Joe.
I mean, he's not here. That's fine.
I can't say bad things about you now.
Hold on, I'll step out.
For inviting us here tonight as well, and also for producing a really good documentary about the Peters Margonaut House, and it's a delight to work with Joe at the University of Evansville, so thank you, Joe. Also, thank you, of course, to Indiana Landmarks, to other colleagues at the University of Evansville. Brian Lynch in the chemistry department has done a beautiful recreation of a bookshelf in the living room. Ann Powell in biology has provided us with very good counsel about what kind of plants we should use to decorate the house. Of course, the city of Evansville, the community, who, again, I think this is another piece of the story of historical preservation in Evansville, the people who came together to preserve, you know, to preserve the Owen Block, and also the Greyhound station, and people who continue to be interested in architecture downtown, the Wright's home in particular, but other homes around there. If you would like a tour, please contact this email right here, pmhouse@evansville.edu. You may also contact me via my email, but I prefer if you use this email, because then this goes to the four people, including myself, who give tours of the house. We are working on a web presence on our UB's website. We're not quite there yet. We should be there, fingers crossed, before Thanksgiving. So we don't have a dedicated web page yet, but we're getting close. I'd also like you to consider joining the Friends of the Peters Margonaut House. There will be rectangular cards back there if you are interested in joining the Friends of the Peters Margonaut House. There are a couple of things back there that you may also be interested in. For those of you who are interested in really how Wes Peters' time in Evansville fits into his overall career, there are issues of the OAD for sale for $20. This talks about his time in Evansville. This is, of course, a fundraiser for the house. Then there are these pamphlets, which also have some of the same information, for $2. The postcards are, of course, free. And finally, this is my pitch for t-shirts. So They didn't know we were going to bring swag when we came. So the shirts are look like this, and this is a large. Jim mentioned the CHOP. So the CHOP is an architectural monogram, and two of the colors that Frank Lloyd Wright used a great deal were Cherokee red and this goldenrod yellow. So here we have Wes Peters' CHOP, his architectural monogram, and the colors that were so kind of common to Frank Lloyd Wright's studio. And my final pitch will be that these shirts are really soft. So they are for sale for $20 as well. It is a fundraiser. And so Jim and I will be back there in a few minutes if you're interested in any of this. So we will be happy to take questions. I'm sure there are some. Yeah. Oh, the house itself cost $15,000, and then $200,000.
And the house
was the exactly. So yeah. So the figure that comes to mind is we've raised $225,000, but really a fraction of that was the actual move of the house. And Mike Diefendahl, his company moved the house. And he was great. He just looked at our critique house and he said, no problem. He said, I moved, Victorian homes, and this one will be great. It did a great job. One of my favorite pictures from that day was the front page of the Courier and Press where it's coming down. Weinbach passed the fraternity houses, and there's a guy they're sitting on top of the house and it's moving down the street.
I did risk my life before the move, though. The first time that Mike wanted to see what the route might be, and so I got in a Big Mike's pickup truck. I'm saying, going out this way, and a mover, when he's driving his pickup truck, he's going this way.
To me,
HSP. So, but if you Google daughter, there's all kinds of interesting articles about Stella actually had a successful writing career. She lectured, she lived in Princeton, New Jersey. Oh, good, there are two of her books right there. Oh, well, there's a book, actually, I think on the right-hand side, it's called Stalin's Daughter, and that's a very good read. Yeah. That's about Svetlana Stalin. The one on the left is one of Svet's books, or Svetlana's books, right?
Yes. Yes.
She was 20 letters to a friend, and then I can't remember.
This is only one year.
That's one of two, and she wrote 20 letters to a friend as well. Yeah, my eyesight's not that good anymore, so. Other questions?
Why was the house built on Indiana Street on Rapid Garage? Where the house was there before that was built?
So the lot was owned by Frederick Romer Pierce, who was Wes Pierce's father, and rented it to Judy's dad and mom. And there wasn't another house on that lot before, was there?
But there were houses around.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Lots of kind of bungalow-style houses, again, flush, like I love that kind of aerial view that you get to see the traditionally favored type of architecture on that screen. Other questions? Yeah.
How famous do you think Peters really is? He was really sort of the backbone of a lot of Wright's stuff, and would you think he would have been the creator of maybe 100 houses or 50 structures? How many total structures was Peters involved with Frank Lloyd Wright?
Well, he became the head of the Taliesin Foundation after Frank Lloyd Wright died. And so he was responsible for executing the projects that were not done. So the Guggenheim wasn't done. The Guggenheim was begun in 58 or 59, and Wright dies in 59. He also finished up the Van Wetzel Auditorium in Sarasota, Florida. He finished up several other projects that Frank Lloyd Wright had planned but never executed. So I don't know that I could put a number on it. It might be better putting a number on the amount of buildings that
he did. You mean him as the architect of record or just participate?
Just how much did he participate? Because he's really an engineering genius out of Evansville.
Yeah.
And, so really a lot of credit should be given to him more than he even is given.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. There's a kind of a word around the Taliesin would be, if there was a problem, Wright could say, get Wes.
Yeah.
And so many times I'm sure that he contributed his wisdom. He then had a career of his own in which he created a number of structures, but basically he was Wright's right-hand man and top engineer. There was a story one time, some people from MIT came out to visit after Wright died, and they asked if they could look at some of the files. They went into this mathematician into this room and stayed there. They thought, maybe there's something wrong with that. They went look, and he was just being so amazed. He said that we had been trying to come up with an algorithm to build something or other for 15 years, and we finally got it. Wes Peters had it, you know, 30 years before using a slide rule. So he was, by all accounts, a genius.
He worked on the cantilevering at Falling Water. Maybe some of, probably a lot of you have been to Falling Water and talking. So, I mean, I think he was also kind of the gentle giant. And again, I'll go back to my anecdote about coming up with inorganic solutions to Frank Lloyd Wright's organic architecture.
And UV, about 2 years ago, you had all kinds of stuff from what's the name of that place?
Taliesin.
Yeah. You had all kinds of stuff, original stuff that you spread out in the Ridgeway room and the iCamp room.
Yes.
It was original work, and then they took it all back, but it was available to all of us to see.
Right. So
what was that stuff?
That was Bill Scott's lecture 2 years ago. And Bill Scott is a Taliesin engineer, an architect associated with Taliesin. He's an archivist. He's writing a book on Wes Peters, and so he has a wonderful archival material. So I'm hoping that comes out in this year or so.
A lot of that material is in the OAE journal, but Bill Scott wrote that article, and a lot of that is his original
work. I wonder, Judy, would you mind just, that house was so different than your neighbors. I mean, growing up, did you guys realize that and think, why does our house look became the tiny house in the romantic home today.
Any other questions?
Thank you very much.